Now, you may not be familiar with that particular image we began this video with, but you've certainly seen other images just like it. Images that seem to personify the pacific and serene character of a natural scene like that. It's a romanticized idea of serenity, with the moon in the sky, the light from the moon on the waters of the lake. It's a beautiful image, and I think it's one we recognize immediately as a romanticized view of the moon in a landscape. But is it really an image of serenity?
It's billions of tons of mass moving at 2.5 times the speed of sound.
So, a multi-billion ton supersonic wrecking ball whirling around the Earth every 29 days. It's not a picture of serenity that I can really cotton to all that easily. Now, it's the thin end of a very large wedge, because that idea of the contrast between what the moon is really doing and our ideas of how it looks in the sky is really at the heart of what we're trying to do in this video. And that's get you to take a look at some of those assumptions that you've probably had with you the greater part of your life about the moon, and maybe actually stops you seeing the moon as it really is. When the moon is full, we could be forgiven for thinking we're actually seeing 50%. One half of the moon unseen to us at the rear, and the rest of it fully illuminated at the front. In actual fact, you're only seeing about 41% of the moon. We've got to work through the moon's librations to be able to see any more than that 41%. Eventually, the moon will actually show us, in the course of typically of a year, as much as 59% of its surface. And it does this because it makes these little movements in its orbit, showing us a little bit more of the top at some time, a little bit more of the chin, a little bit more of this side, a little bit more of that side. But you don't see that in any one night. You're probably only seeing at any one time around about 41% of the moon's surface. This happens because at the side of the limb here, where as you're facing the moon, this strip all the way around the circumference of the moon here, you can't really see that, and it's actually quite a wide portion. So really, you're only seeing about 41%. It's a huge chunk of real estate. In fact, it's a massive chunk of real estate. The entire surface area of the moon is something like 37 million square kilometers. Now, give some consideration to something like that we're a bit more familiar with. If I can rotate it around the right way so that we can actually see it. The continent of Africa here. Everyone's pretty familiar with the what a big chunk of real estate Africa is. Well, you're talking about around about 30 million square kilometers here with Africa. So when you're looking at the moon, you're looking at something larger. Even if you bear in mind what I told you earlier on, that you're only actually seeing about 41% of the surface of the moon, that still translates to 15 million square kilometers shining down on your garden in Ilford, England, or Des Moines, Iowa, or wherever you happen to be. Another area where you're probably going to get a big surprise is Earth-lunar distancing. And it's another demonstration of how little most people know about something that is a great commonplace about our moon, its distance from us. One of the problems is all of the pictures you've been shown in books have tended to show you a distorted graphic representation of the Earth-Moon distance. And bear in mind, you've got no direct experience when you look at the moon in the sky. There's nothing there to give you any kind of clue. It's not like going down to the bottom of the garden. It's not like taking a trip in the car where you get a kind of familiarity in the landscape. There's none of that when you're actually observing the moon. You're very dependent on stuff you know. Now, even if you know the distance to the moon in miles or kilometers as an answer to a trivia quiz that you may have memorized, it still doesn't really tell you anything about the physical embodiment of the distance to the Earth or the moon. Just take a look at a typical textbook here on astronomy. It's absolutely full of pictures that show an apparent representation of the Earth-Moon relationship as a graphic image. This is a classic, lovely image here of the Moon and the Earth together. Let's look at some of these other images here, because it'll make my point, I think, quite nicely. There we go. Here's the Earth and the Moon again in this picture. Here's a good one. Go over the other page here as well. Look, a terrific picture here of the moon and the earth as a real photograph. Look at the relationship between the images there. And if we keep going, this book is absolutely full of nice little illustrations, all of which I think we're all familiar with. We've all seen these in encyclopedias and probably on the overhead transparencies that our teachers showed us at school. And here's another one. Earth and Moon again over here. And here's another one. Earth and Moon being presented. In fact, we could go on and on with this. I'm sure you've got plenty of books on your shelf at home that are going to show images very similar to this. And the big problem is that a book page really is a bit of a problem for a graphic artist to actually represent these two bodies together. As familiar as you seem to be with the moon, you really actually know very little about it. Take a look at this. We've got a model here of the Earth-Moon system. The Earth is represented by this 70mm ball, and on this scale, the moon is this 19mm ball. Now, you remember the pictures were showing us pretty much this kind of relationship between the Earth-Moon. Now, here's a question for you. How close is it on this scale? 70mm Earth, 19mm moon. Is it this far? Does this look a little bit more like it? Take a look at this. Thank you. Now, you saw when we were doing that street astronomy in the park and we were doing the demonstration with my now rather battered looking aspirin of making the gap of 6 millimeters that the moon will fit into very easily. We glossed over a fact that the moon does actually vary in size slightly. Now, this is not contradicting anything we said earlier. The variation in the size of the moon, the main variation in the size of the moon, actually comes from the fact that its orbit around the Earth is elliptical rather than circular. If you look at our orrery model here again, and we just show you it very quickly, the moon, as it's seen swinging around the Earth here in the model, is actually shown going around actually in a circle. But the real moon in its transit around the Earth actually goes round in an ellipse. So at some point in the orbit, it's closer to the Earth, and at other points, it's a little bit further away. Now, that actually accounts for a change in the visual diameter of the moon of about 14%. Now, in the picture, you can see that it's a fairly significant change, but in actual fact, when you relate it to the aspirin that we were holding up in the park, the aspirin is still going to cover it even when it's 14% bigger, because it's only 0.8 of a millimeter change in the apparent diameter of the moon in the sky, and it's actually very difficult to see that. It builds up very gradually, so again, this apparent change that you get with the harvest moon looking very big on the horizon and much smaller when it's in the sky, that really is just a perceptual illusion. There's another source of apparent variation in the visual angle or the diameter of the moon as we see it in the sky that's very easy to explain, and it comes from a very simple source, that of the rotation of the Earth itself. I can show it to you on the model that we've got here. If I bring Britain round to this position, so we're actually facing the moon here, at this position the moon would appear to be high in the sky, but as time passes the Earth is going to rotate. And you can see that as I move it away, now the moon is going to appear very near the horizon in the west. And as a result of this, you can actually see that the rotation of the Earth has actually taken Britain probably about another 3,000 miles further away from the moon. And that change in distance accounts for about a 1% change in the diameter of the moon as we see it. Now, the odd thing is, that's in complete contradiction to our apparent conviction that when the moon is near the horizon, it's significantly bigger. It's quite wrong. When it's near the horizon, it's about 1% smaller than you would have seen it when it was higher in the sky. Okay, we're just going to show you that on our stellarium projection system that we've actually got in our showroom. So first of all, I'm just going to switch the atmosphere off so that you can see things a little bit clearer. And now I'm going to actually speed everything up a bit. I'm just going to click that through. You'll see the stars starting to move now quite quite readily. See them ticking by, and I'm going to speed it up a bit more. Now it's moving, I'm advancing the clock really quite quickly, but you still can't see this apparent change in size. So I'm going to give it another kick. There you go. Now you can see the moon gently pulsating backwards and forwards, literally as the day clicks past. So this is a daily change in the apparent size. Now obviously I've switched off the terrain as well, otherwise we'd only have a few hours every day to actually see the moon. Now, but I'll count the clock off for you now. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Could you see how that, as I was counting the days off there, the pulsations actually stay in perfect time with the days as they actually tick away? Give some consideration to the fact that it's an ancient landscape, and the large scale details of the moon's surface that you can see as a naked eye view have not changed for millions of years. So it's pretty much the case that every human being who has ever lived is seeing the moon or saw the moon the same way that you see it today. Doesn't matter if it was Genghis Khan or Socrates or even Jack the Ripper and John F. Kennedy. They all saw the moon exactly the same way you see it today. There are very few places, I think, that you could point to in the world where there is that absolute certainty that you're seeing it the same today as they saw it then. Certainly not in the area of Ilford or Des Moines or wherever you happen to be. Now, up to now, we've been talking about the moon as it applies to the naked eye. And frequent viewers, I'm sure, will know that we're an organization very much behind the promotion of telescopic astronomy. I'm going to show you a little demonstration now about some of the tourist sites that you can really see on the moon that are pretty impressive. And to do that, I'm going to use an application for an iPad. Also works on your iPhone as well. Only costs you a few pounds. And it's a great way of doing armchair astronomy. This really is a nice app with a real fun feel to it. It's called Moon Globe HD, by the way. It's got this very nice feature of a slider at the side here that we can just pull backwards and forwards to actually change the phase of the moon and investigate it, investigate the shadow and contrast detail. It's a really nice way of doing it. I could play with this for hours. Anyway, just to move in and take a look, what I want to show you here is a feature on the moon, a chain of mountains called the Apennine Mountains. There's actually one of the most spectacular mountain ranges, not just on the moon, but in the whole solar system. It really is an impressive range of mountains here. If I'm going to go in a little bit tighter, I'm actually going to go to one particular peak that I've visited quite a few times with a telescope. And I know my way to it by finding a little crater just here. I'm just going to point to that instead of getting my hands in the way. There's a little crater here called Huxley. And I'm just going to bring that up to full size. I'm just going to adjust the illumination slightly as well, just to give us a bit more shadow detail. There we go. The area I want to show you is just here. This is Mons Huygens, or Mount Huygens. Now, this mountain peak actually soars over the lunar plain here a full nearly 3 miles. Now, that's as high as Everest. But of course, it's an Everest that you can see from your back garden. It's been the primary mission of this video to make you think about the moon and the way the sheer weight of our everyday familiarity with our nearest companion in space has really robbed you of the opportunity to see it as an incredible, exciting and continental-sized place in the sky. I'm hoping that we may have helped you to shake off that dulling sense of familiarity with the moon and inspire you not just to take another look at the moon, but to take a first proper look at the moon. That's it for now. Don't forget to click the button right here to subscribe if you want to see more videos like this. Clear skies to all. Bye for now.
Save the world. I've always wanted to do that.